As a trans feminist organization, we are confronted with each of these, social class, caste mainly, but also those of others, ethnicity, language, region, disability. And this we've been doing for the past number of years, where we partner very closely with Shanhita, which has been a feminist activist space and Eastern India's first gender resource center. We also realize that the arc of sexuality rights organizing, at least in this country, and there are, of course, resonances elsewhere too, it fails to understand and address the questions around caste and class privilege broadly, and located, as it were, rather disproportionately from the bodies and struggles of working class and caste minority, sexual gender minorities, trans persons. The fulcrum of these movements are then poised around the removal of Section 377, almost obfuscating other realities faced on a daily basis by a vast majority of our communities, whether it be eviction or detention, arrest as homeless, or vagrants or sex workers or what have you, under other legal provisions such as each city has them, city legislations, ordinances, police acts, anti-vagrancy, anti-begging, etc. Sometimes these are not acts, but these are attitudes and these are deep-set prejudices. As trans feminists, we have always been eager to critically engage with people's movements from our subjective position of being a collective of mainly working-class transgender persons and communities. And while I say this, I also want to highlight that we are aware of the inherent hierarchies and privileges that many of us embody. Rituparno Ghosh, in whose name we have the lecture, has been a director, artist, editor. He wore many caps. It's difficult always, like I say this, to speak of him in the past tense. And each of these roles he played with equal rigor and discipline. He also does have a rather unsettling presence in the Bengali psyche, or at least here in Calcutta, especially the later Rituparno, due to his public transgression of gender lines. Many of us have drawn strength and succor from this, and he almost has a talismanic presence for gender nonconformity and other trans communities who express their gender identities differently here. However, if one were to look deeply at the broad spectrum of his cinematic work, spanning nearly a decade and a half, and his writing, we can see how he has been vocal against every single strand of structural oppression. The memorial lecture, thus, was instituted in his name, signifying a person or a persona whose keen sense of human dignity and vulnerability made him respond to these rather vocally and often very, very controversially. For the third lecture, we are rather privileged to have amidst us P. Sainath, whose intelligent and insightful views on a range of issues spanning agriculture, caste, media, and other matters have been greatly appreciated by many of us and countless readers. And he's recipient of many awards and fellowships, including the Magsaysay Award. And PS has been a visiting lecturer in journalism, development, and politics at universities in India and across the globe. Today, he is going to traverse with us a journey with the People's Archive for Rural India, or PARI, speaking about the everyday life of everyday people, recapturing the rural in the digital age. May I please welcome Mr. P. Sainath.
Thank you very much, Anindu, and I'm honored and grateful to have been invited here to present the third Rituparno Ghosh Memorial Lecture. What do we mean when we are talking about the rural or the recapture of the rural? Here's a huge problem you have in your media. You have the world's most diverse, complex, and heterogeneous society, or societies in plural. You have this incredibly diverse cultures and societies, and you have an unbelievably narrow, concentrated media trying to cover that diversity, not even trying. You cannot have such an incredible world covered by such a tiny media. By the way, this is the paradox of your freedom struggle. It's the paradox of the Indian media. It's the media paradox. In the late 1800s and up to 1940, a tiny Indian media, tiny, Gandhi's print order for his publications was 5,000, 3,000, 6,000. Tilak's was less. A tiny Indian media fulfilled a gigantic social role. Today, a gigantic Indian media served the narrowest of purposes and social role. This is the paradox of our time. Understand exactly what it is that your media cover. Forget rural India, they don't cover urban India either. The Center for Media Studies, Delhi, monitors six major newspapers, three Hindi, three English, national publications, and six major television channels, three Hindi, three English, the top ones. What does it show? They've taken, say, one I extracted from their data. For newspapers, they do the front page on this particular study, and for television, they do the prime time. They look at prime time coverage. Yeah. The average Indian newspaper, the front page, 66% is New Delhi. Prime time is 58% New Delhi. Now, we're not talking about the share amongst cities. We're talking about the share of the total front page. 66% is New Delhi, and that is largely Lutyens' Delhi. Okay? It isn't Jahangir, Puri, and a lot of other places like that. The second phenomenon is that, what about the other three metros? Sorry guys, you're at the bottom. Mumbai comes next and has more than Kolkata and Chennai together, because, you know, we have Bollywood and we have Dalal Street. We are the stock exchange. So that makes us much more, it makes us a hell of a lot more important than a bunch of Kolkatans. That's the third thing. Chennai gets more than you because of the IT and the historic association of the publication world with Chennai, and the fact that an incredibly Brahmanical and Brahminized bureaucracy sits in Delhi, which has its roots in Tamil Nadu, very, very significantly. So then you guys bring up a very poor fourth, and then come the tier 2, tier 3 cities, the Bengaluru's, Hyderabad's, Nagpur's, Chandigarh's, they get a pretty negligible share as well. How many cities and towns are there in India with a population of more than 1 million? Go back and check. We are talking about dozens. Okay? So your media aren't even covering urban India, forget rural India. Then if you start breaking it up, that's in terms of news origin. If you break it up in terms of news content, subject-wise, topic-wise, village India, village stories, get all of 0.18%. Agriculture gets 0.61%, but what's called agricultural reporting is largely coverage of the agriculture ministry, not of the field, not of the farm. Okay. I mean, you can go on playing with the CMS data. It's very telling, it's very striking. So, what are we covering in the media? Not very much. You cover rural India when there are desperate outbreaks of some terrible disease, you know, maybe avian flu, or there's an earthquake in Manipur, then otherwise, or there's an Iram Sharmila and who has just gone off a fast, so you get something covered. Rural India gets covered during what the media like to call a great drought, or in Maharashtra, the greatest drought of the century or 70 years. Anything to qualify for coverage has to be, you know, greatest, shortest, fattest, tallest, something. And then you can justify it's coming into the newspaper. So these are the priorities. If you look at what it is that newspaper reporters are assigned to do, or channel reporters are assigned to do, you will find there is not a single full-time labor reporter in the country. A full-time labor reporter. I joined journalism in 1980, and every newspaper had a labor reporter. You will not find a single full-time agriculture correspondent. I was it. And I didn't do that full-time. I did other things. I covered non-agricultural issues in the countryside. But your agriculture reporter, something like the Yeti, sightings have been heard of, but no one's actually established the existence. The agriculture reporter is somebody who talks to the ministry, works from press releases, covering from, you know, from Gaon to the Mandi. That's gone. That still happens in the very local columns of newspapers. It's not a national practice, and there are no correspondents for it. On the other hand, there are newspapers with full-time correspondents on glamour, design. My favorite, which I've always wanted to be and never landed, is the eating out correspondent. But no luck. I'm pretty nasty about them because I'm jealous. So there are eating out correspondents. There are one venerable newspaper in the east of India. Even once, you see now, the earlier order in the 80s and 90s was political correspondence. Like I was, the guys who tell you Prime Minister said here today. Okay. And then came sports correspondence, which in India largely used to mean cricket correspondence. Though there was one venerable newspaper in the east which had a full-time golf correspondent. Now the statistical negligibility of golf in India is beyond my mathematical ability to calculate. So we'll skip that. Then now all have been outshone. The last 25 years, which now are being celebrated in Delhi as the age of the reforms, have seen business correspondents overtake all other tribes. A general interest newspaper can have 14 to 20 people covering business and such finely honed nuances of, there's one of my friends in Bombay whose only job is to cover futures. You know, I think it must be a completely miserable job. What the heck will you do reporting futures? But since he earns six times what I do, I suppose he's happy. So let me not indulge in that kind of grudge. So this is your media world. The media cover what delivers revenue. It's revenue driven. If you're going to bring in revenue, you get covered. If you don't, you won't. In 2006, by the way, I teach journalism and my students are in every newspaper and channel in this country of any significance, but in 2006, some of my students in Times of India were desperate as, and that is the healthy part of the Indian media, as thousands of young journalists in this country are desperate to do something different, to cover something differently. I know how many hundreds of emails I get from young journalists and journalism students across the country. I teach occasionally at Shantiniketan, and the students from there have done fantastic work for the site, which I'll show you. Outstanding work. The young are, you know, the cynicism is our generation. The young are desperate to do things, to get out and connect with human beings, connect with people, tell stories, which is what journalism is about. It's not happening. You're revenue driven. When the Times in 2006 issued a memo, because the kids raised it in the newspaper saying, look, the Hindu is covering the farm suicides. I used to be in the Hindu in that avatar. This Hindu is covering this, they're covering Maharashtra. The Maharashtra Times people told their editors that an English newspaper is covering rural Maharashtra more in more detail than the Marathi press. A memo was issued which told the reporters, dying farmers in Vidarbha don't buy our newspaper. The elites of South Mumbai do. They were told in such explicit, clear terms what the priorities of reporting were. Still, and having said that, let me say this, and again I make this point about the young. The finest rural reporting, the cutting edge reporting, rural reporting in Kolkata, in India, is coming from a reporter in the Times of India called Priyanka Kakotkar. The cutting edge reporting on the beef ban, on the drought, on the water crisis, I am very proud to say she was a student of mine, but I think there are 1,000 Priyankas across the country waiting for that opening, looking for that chance. Okay. So in 2006, I give you that year because another interesting thing happened. The highest number of suicides per day were happening in Vidarbha, and at the same time in Mumbai, the Lakme Fashion Week was on. I did a count. How many journalists from outside Vidarbha are covering the farm suicides? There were six of us. And two of those were there by accident because they had missed their flight out. And the assembly session was on and they couldn't get onto the... So they were there perforce, I mean, by, you know, unwilling week they spent in Vidarbha. At the Lakme Fashion Week in Mumbai, accredited journalists covering the Lakme Fashion Week, 512. And those covering it on a daily pass, another 100. So 600 journalists covering Lakme Fashion Week, 1 hour away. The flight from Mumbai to Nagpur is an hour. Six journalists were covering the largest wave of suicides ever seen in this country. Now, there was an irony, a tremendous irony to it. The irony was that, what was the theme of Lakme Fashion Week? Lakme Fashion Week, the models on the ramp were displaying the theme, cotton. 1 hour's flight away, the men, women and children who grew the cotton were killing themselves at the rate of 8 every day. You know, if for no other reason, that made it news. But it wasn't covered that way. Until much later, it took us years to put it on the agenda and to get it covered. Okay, so this is the media thing, what's happening, what is the rule? This year, everything covered as a crisis in drought. The media love drought and floods because it allows us to reduce the problems of the countryside or of society to natural calamity and absolve ourselves of our own role in creating that. Now, you all heard of the great drought of Maharashtra. One of the things my friend Jaideep Hardikar, who works with the Telegraph, and I did for many weeks in the summer, was to trace the source of many rivers, 6 rivers in all. We went back to the source and tried to figure out why these rivers had gone dry for the first time in 140 years. Godavari for the first time in 139 years. By the way, the very same factors that cause drought in the summer, the very same factors cause floods in the monsoon. Yeah, the deforestation, the development process, the concretization. What did they do in Godavari? I'll tell you that, and then we get into the whole thing of rural India. Every inch of that town, or called Trimbak or Trimbakeshwar, which consecrates the river, has been made concrete. The water of the Godavari, which becomes a gigantic river in Andhra, comes in little trickles from a stream on the top of a mountain called Brahmagiri. Those 8-10 little streams meet at the Ganga Sagar, move into the Ramkunda, and then you have a mighty river. Now you've concreted the entire town. Those little trickles in summer have nowhere to meet and collect. They have nowhere to meet and collect. So they go dry. Then, when the monsoon comes and you have huge amounts of water streaming down the mountain, the water comes down, meets the barriers of the concrete, surpasses the concrete, you have floods. Added to this, of course, is all the deforestation, the construction, the building of hotels, resorts, and everything else, and promotion of religious tourism. The entire food crop, you all heard about the miseries of Marathwada. Look at, and Nashik is a different area, Marathwada is a different area. Here's what happened. The water of the Godavari gets collected in a few tanks, in a few reservoirs. You know, whether it is Jayakwadi or even higher up, there are 2-3 tanks, Ganga and others. What happened? Somebody just decided to transfer 1.3 thousand million cubic feet. 1.3 TMC was transferred on executive order to the Kumbh Mela that they were promoting in Nashik. Now, the entire farming belt of Nashik, which is grape growers, Nashik is where your grapes come from, they took such a hit. Grape growing requires 3 rotations. Those upstream closest to the river got 2. Those downstream got 1. They were finished by it. They were completely finished by this simple act of transferring 1 point. The total amount in the dams at that time was 4.2 million, out of which you have put 1/3 for promoting religious tourism. The second problem that happened was that water then picked up an enormous amount of pollution, and then the third, the Ramkunda went dry for the first time in 139 years. The Ramkunda is the sacred bathing ghat of the Godavari, the holiest part of the Godavari for the people of Nashik and elsewhere. It's where people immersed the ashes of their loved ones and bathed also in the Shani Snan or the royal bath or the cleansing bath. The ghat is made up of rocks that are millions of years old. Deccan rock, it's millions of years old. But this is Maharashtra, the lead foremost capitalist state in the country, full of dynamic entrepreneurs. What did they do? They completely destroyed the rock ghat and replaced it with marble and concrete. Yeah. Having done that, The Ram Kunda went dry. Now they were faced with the embarrassment. There are hundreds and hundreds of tons of human remains in the area of the Ram Kunda. They were at one point removing them with 20 trucks a day. So they decided that they had to fill up the Ram Kunda. What is the Ram Kunda? It's a ghat on the river. So how did they fill up the Ram Kunda? By pouring water from 90 tankers a day into a river, making you the only nation in the world, India first, make in India, you're the only nation in the world pouring millions of liters of water into a river from tankers which have looted the water from other public sources, from public lakes, municipal tanks, taps, yeah? And you pour that public water into the Kunda. I mean, but this is just a small example of thousands of such things that happen across rural India, across your country. What are we talking about when we say rural India? We are talking about the most complex part of planet Earth. Okay? You're talking about 833 million human beings speaking 780 languages, six of which are spoken by more than 50 million people, three of which are spoken by more than 80 million, one of which is spoken by more than 500 million, some of which are now spoken down to the last speaker, like Jeru in the Andamans, I'm told, but certainly down to seven speakers for the language called Saimar in Tripura, in your neighbors, the language of the Saimaris tribe. The Saimaris tribe, there are 300 tribals. The language is down to the last seven speakers. I'll show you the last authority on the Saimaris language. Now, why is it, and this is apart from these 780 living languages, 225 Indian languages, mainly rural, have died in the last 50 years. It's very nice to wake up and feel rich. Gosh, we have 780 languages. Nobody else does. I feel rich in Mumbai when you take the public train and I can identify 21 languages spoken on the train. It's a great feeling. You're entitled to it. But less than 4% of your 780 languages have schooling beyond fifth standard. Unless the language exists in the schools and the child is speaking it to the mother at home, it will not survive. Right? But instead, we are promoting Sanskrit. Nobody speaks it at home. And not a single one, and I don't think most of the ministers promoting it speak it either. I mean, if they'd wanted to promote it, they could have made it a compulsory retrospective action and subtitled all or redubbed all Smriti Irani's serials in Sanskrit, and I'm sure that would promote the language. I'm very sure it would. It would get more viewers, there's no doubt about that. But rich languages with tremendous legacies are dying. Okay. Look, in the state of West Bengal, many, many separatist and other problems are tied to linguistic identities. These are so important to us politically, culturally, otherwise. They're dying. And people are resisting and fighting, but languages die. Another thing, apart from this, there is no other part of the world where 780 living languages exist. I travel each year in Odisha from Kalahandi to Koraput within that one state. It's 280 kilometers. I take a week because my friend Purusottam Thakur, Jagdish Suna, we stop every few kilometers. You know why? On that 280 kilometers, 40 languages are spoken. What an astonishing country you live in. 40 languages are spoken. The heart, the village heart, is something spectacular. 16 languages spoken, arguments, fights. People are transacting with each other I don't know your language, you don't know my language. We quarrel, fight, bargain, bicker, sell, get drunk, fight, go home. For me, by the way, it's a microcosm of what India was and could be. That willingness to engage and accommodate someone entirely different from yourself. Someone who has nothing in common with you. Not language, not culture, not region, well, the region they have in common. But that's it. Then you have incredible occupational diversity. There are occupations still alive in India, alive nowhere else in the world. Like the Kalasis of Malabar. Still performing a role the Phoenicians did in Europe 2000 years ago. Launching boats. They're still doing it in the Gulf states, for Saudi Arabia, for Dubai. The Kalasis, largely, entirely Muslim community. They were there before Christ. And there was a huge sea-going traffic between India and the Levant and other places long before. By the way, Konganallur is where the Apostle St. Thomas is supposed to have landed. There's a lot of dispute about whether he actually did. But we've built a grave for him in Chennai, so I suppose somebody came. And this is the situation. Unbelievable diversity of occupations. In year 2000, a cyclone pushed a train off the bridge in Kerala. The army couldn't get the train out. They recruited the Kalasis, who went into the river and had the train out in 100 hours. They didn't tire. The army cranes could not reach the train. The Kalasis went and brought it to the shore from where the army took over. It was a joint venture of army and Kalasis, and they got it out. How did the Kalasis do it? If you ask them, who are you, what do? They tell you, we are hydraulics experts, and they are. The ancient problem was, how do you get a full giant wooden boat from a dry area to the sea without damaging the bottom? That's what the Kalasis did. They went into the river, created underground canals, channels, and used the force and current of the river in spate to move the train towards the shore. Linguistic diversity, occupational diversity, cultural diversity, just amazing. And yet, the same rural India, be very clear about it, is also home to some of the world's greatest barbarism, nastiness, cruelty, untouchability, caste, which is, by the way, not restricted to rural India. A lot of us like to think of ourselves as very superior. That's what happens out in the villages. Just pick up your newspaper on Sunday and see the matrimonials. You'll know how much caste there is in urban India. Okay? I don't know of any classified matrimonials in rural India, but urban India is, and the worst, most castiest ads come from NRIs, who specify the gotra of that bride. Okay? I mean, that narrow. So, rural India also has the bestial, the barbaric, alongside the beautiful and the brilliant. What's happening in the last 25 years of the reforms is that the beautiful and the brilliant is collapsing. It's a severe erosion. The bestial and the barbaric are getting strengthened. Example, school after school of weaving and pottery are dying, but the Haryana khaps are doing very well, thank you. They're much stronger. As a journalist of 36 years, I'm telling you, the Haryana khaps are much stronger today than they were 30 years ago when I was a young reporter. Today, the chief minister is a supporter. 30 years ago, they used to fear the police. They used to fear the law and order. Now, they are the law and order missionary. It's their law. So something, there's a barbaric and terrible transition taking place in the countryside. There is this beauty, there is this language, there is this literature, there's this brilliance that is in erosion. What exactly of this do your media tell you? in an attempt to try and get something that acquaints our children and future generations, to give them a living textbook, a textbook that is constantly updated, and a textbook that is often written by the children themselves. We created the People's Archive of Rural India. Our masthead, our commitment is, we cover the everyday lives of everyday people. That's what we cover. Okay, there's no celebrity here. We celebrate the ordinary Indian. Second, we're trying to get this journalism as close. I think the basic problem of journalism and the basic duty of us in this era is, how do we take I want you to know something. Journalism, art, literature did not come out of corporate investments, nor out of government projects. Journalism, art, literature, communication came out of communities and societies. For me, the challenge of the digital age, how do we take journalism, reclaim the media commons, and return it to communities and societies? Let people tell their own stories. We're trying that, we're doing it. We distributed through a Fulbright scholar who worked with us. He got 6 ordinary people, including Adivasi women workers in the Bandipur forest, to shoot whatever they wanted to shoot about wildlife. The farmer shot it from the point of view of wildlife farmer conflict. The woman worker in the forest shot it from the point of view of security of her nieces and daughters going through the jungle to the school. These photographs and these stories, as a photographer of 36 years, I will never be able to match them. I will never be able to. They are seen through an entirely different universe. They are seen through entirely different pairs of eyes. Okay? Don't underestimate what people can do in journalism, in art, in literature. This is a nation of storytelling. Okay? But storytellers are dying. That art of storytelling, the Harikatha, the Burakatha, all these traditions are in erosion. On the People's Archive of Rural India, one, we try getting ordinary people, we cover the lives of ordinary people. Two, we cover both. We cover the bestial and the barbaric, we cover the beautiful and the brilliant. We cover the conflicts that are on in the countryside. One of our projects, by the way, audio, is to record every spoken tongue in this country. We don't take the position of what is a language and what is a debate. We leave that to people who have the mental energy to waste on that debate. Your language is my dialect. Yeah? We have a democratic word for it. We call it tongues. Everybody's got a tongue. You can say they don't have a language or they don't have a dialect, but everybody's got a tongue. We call it tongues. Our aim is to record every spoken tongue, and I'm inviting you. If you meet someone, rural Indian, I want any one of the languages spoken in West Bengal. So you will then record, one of the things that I'd ask you to record is the most common proverb in that language. Imagine 780. You'll be collecting languages and wisdom. That's what we're doing. Let me tell you one of our latest acquisition, because we have really acquired it. A French ethnomusicologist has gifted us free. It costs us a bomb. The free costs us a bomb to integrate into our site. He has gifted us his lifetime's work from Maharashtra, 1,10,000 songs sung by Marathi women at the workplace, at the chakki, in the kitchen, because they recognize domestic work as work. Okay, in the kitchen, with the chakki, with the baby, bringing up children is work. In the field, in the harvest, in the sowing, in the seeding. I didn't know there were
110,000 songs by Marathi women. We've got them. We've got them all recorded. We've got the recordings. They are digitized. They have. That's his life's work. Now we will integrate them. There are 200 Ambedkar songs by Dalit women. Can you put a price on this? So why don't you do it for us in Bengali? Why don't you guys form a team and tell us that we will do this collection of songs sung by Bengali women on these occasions, at work. Give us that. 40,000 of the songs have been translated already. You guys want to take this on? Then you can also, by the way, apart from the songs database, do things on music, singing, poetry, language. Do that. We are a multimedia digital platform. We'll carry all of this. It's not a free-for-all. You can't go up and put up anything you like. It's heavily edited. I didn't spend 36 years in journalism to let any crap go up. And we will intervene heavily. We are not Wikipedia. You can't do anything you want. A lot of important decisions are democratically taken by me. We're very democratic. And so this is the thing. Now let me show you something about the People's Archive of India. That's the People's Archive of India. That's our carousel. That's a little girl, Dalit girl in Haryana who goes to school against the wishes of the community in the village. This is the biggest garbage dump outside Pune. The consumption of Pune makes a couple of villages there victims of their garbage. Okay, this is okay. Suppose you want to go to that story. You click on it, and that's the story. Urvashi Sarkar is a Pari fellow, a People's Archive fellow. It's loading very slowly, so you're not seeing the photographs. But we are a visually driven site. Each and every one of these articles will have 6, 7, 10, 12 photographs. So Urvashi has taken some beautiful pictures as well. Urvashi once worked with the Telegraph, with the Hindu, and is now a Pari fellow. But let me show you the front page. Okay, so that you know what it looks like. This is our home page. These are our categories. Things we do is about work. Things we make is about artisans, your weavers, potters, all of them come in here. Farming and its crisis, that's pretty obvious. Let me show you some of the other pages. So let's say let's go to the categories page itself, so that you can see all the 30 odd categories, including a section for school children to write in and send us stuff. And by the way, we have school children who have published a newspaper in Tamil and English on Pari from a forest in Tamil Nadu, in the Uti, in the Idukki Hills, on the border of Kerala and Tamil Nadu. On World Environment Day, that school is 53% Adivasi. It's not your elite school set up for. It is a school of poor children. And we have a section called Musafir, when if you're traveling, you can write stuff. We have, for me, one of the most important sections personally, the last living freedom fighters of India. I'm interviewing them. In 5 years, no one will be left alive. But let me show you the site called Musafir, which is a travel thing. You know, that's Musafir. But let me show you a good Bengali in Tripura whom I met on the road doing the most unbelievable load of carrying bamboos. We thought it was a procession in the mist, but actually, it was Ratan Biswas carrying the longest bamboos. They were 42 to 45 feet in length. On a 4.5 foot cycle, he was carrying 45 feet bamboos. He was carrying 200 kilograms, five bamboos. So each was 40 kilograms. He was carrying 450 pounds on his cycle. And the miracle of it was how he organized it. The cycle would collapse under the weight. He put bamboo hold supports on the side of the bars. So the bamboo was taking the weight of the bamboo. And he was walking 17 kilometers to Agartala market to sell it for next to nothing. Well, we'll leave that on and see what happens. One of our great projects, by the way, is called Faces. We're doing a facial map of India. The sheer diversity of this country, look at it. Just look at some of the faces. All those names, alphabet you see up, all districts starting with A will come under A. I should tell you that right now, the largest number of photographs. Do you know what the aim is? We are going to shoot a male, a female, and a child or adolescent from every district and every block in the country. There are 688 districts and 10,000 blocks. Do you know the state that has done the best so far because of a handful of children aged 21 in Shantiniketan, inspired by their teachers, have shot 400 faces from Bengal from 45 blocks, 34 to 45 blocks, something like that. So the largest number of faces on the site is actually from the state of Bengal, but you're looking at different districts, different states right now. And just to give you an idea of the diversity, let's go to one of these. Let's go to S. This includes, oh, there you are. This is Bengal for you. Now what we do is, along with the photograph, we give you the metadata. And this has been an education to us, even to a rural reporter of 24 years. When we have 100 faces, we have 300 occupations, because poor people have to do three things to survive. So they are part-time agricultural laborers, part-time construction laborers. Yeah. Now that's one from South 24 Paraganas. That's another. Don't you love that face? Look at the fact they're so beautifully shot. These are kids taking the photographs. Okay? First semester student at that time when she shot it, I think. Or second. Okay. All these are from Bengal, then these are from Maharashtra. And suddenly from Srinagar, suddenly from South Andamans, no other part of planet Earth will you find this facial diversity. Look at the guy from Srinagar and the porters from Ladakh to your Jarawa. All, by the way, shot by a Bengali, if you like. Madhushree Mukherjee, author of Churchill's Secret War. She shot this photograph. Yeah, so faces is just one. Then we are doing the recording of the languages. We now have some with us. We are still loading them at the rate of so many a week. We have some 700, 800 faces. We have only 9,000 to go. Anyone can contribute. We want this to be a legacy thing where all Indians feel free to put it up there, give us the photograph, but we need that metadata, occupation, name, village, block. The problem with Bengal is that it has more blocks than any other country, possibly because of population density. UP has 10 blocks, this district, Bengal has 30. I mean, it's crazy. So, faces. We also have the first online library dedicated to rural India. It's called Resources. Anything that we get in soft copy, it could be egg production in Mizoram. If it's rural, we'll carry it. You know what's going to happen in the next few years? Tens of thousands of schools and colleges will go online. Because, not because you and I think it's a good thing, but because industry needs a workforce that can press the right button. So you're going to have an explosion of broadband. But you know what's going to happen? The digital divide will actually deepen. When they go up there in education, there will be kids who have broadband at home versus kids who can't afford textbooks. Pari, is a textbook, a living textbook for those children, for all children, and for all generations. Kids from 10 universities have put up material on Pari. So the students are writing their own textbook for future students.
Okay.
Now, we have carried astonishing reports over here. Let me show you one from Bengal. It is now a book out of print, but you'll find it now on the net because we carried it. It's called Famine Over Bengal. It's a book by the Hindu correspondent in 1944 who had covered the Bengal famine for 3 years. The book went out of print, not available in any library, and the author's son picked up a copy on the Connaught Place pavement or someplace, and it says Delhi University Library. So you know what went out in the Raddi. It's a very good book. Okay? We have carried the full book. We don't give you links, we give you the full text. So even if the government withdraws something from its site, the full report will be on Pari. Like the National Commission for Enterprises in the Unorganized Sector, government has withdrawn some of the reports. You'll find it, the full report, on our site. And we give the proper way of citing a document to the student to teach them that. Okay? Now, we also give 10 factoids, the most important facts in the report or the book. Now, by a researcher or young researcher going through this, by looking at this, knows, is this the report I need to look at? Or is it inappropriate for the project I am doing? Okay, 3 principles of People's Archive. Everyone is free to download free of charge. There is no access, no payment, no subscription fee. Please subscribe, but there's no fee. Second, all that you have to do is to acknowledge Pari. Give us the citation. Third, I mean, your college students making a project, school students making a project, you can download these photographs with our compliments, provided you give the acknowledgments required. 3, you will not use the material for commercial purposes. This is operating not on the line of copyright, but on the line of copyleft. We are under the Creative Commons. We are under Creative Commons version 4.2, which is called non-derivative, non-commercial. So long as you don't derive, you can't steal her work and put it under your name. And you can't commercialize the material. But otherwise, you are free to download. Now imagine that this is constantly generations of students. Pari is now being used in about 20 universities as a teaching resource, including Shantiniketan, the first one, and so far I think the only one in Bengal that is regularly using us. It's being used by journalism schools, being used by sociology departments, it's being used in Ashoka University, in other departments, it's being used in development studies, it's being used in economics. This is it. Now I'm just, you know, I won't have the time, so I'm just going to run you through a few, and then I'm going to show you some actual video clips, because we have video, audio, the whole damn works. Let me show you something. Okay, now this, for instance, is a toddy tapper in Tamil Nadu. It's a talking album where the photographer gives you, I hope it works because it's moving slowly, the photographer gives you audio captions. You know, I got that idea by looking at the work of Sunil Jana on the famine. There were beautiful photographs, and there were photographs that agitated the hell out of me. I wanted to ask Sunil Jana, why did you do this? Your photographs are the most beautiful in the world, but why did you choose to portray this individual in this light? I can't ask him because he's dead. How nice it would have been if we had a talking tour of the photographs by Sunil Jana. So now we have a concept of the talking album. I shot this in 93. His name is Karukavel Nada. You know how many feet he climbs in a day? He
services every day in the season. Karukavel Nadar will climb up and down each of 40 to 50 trees 3 times daily. Some of the trees are well over 30 feet high, but even if most were around 20 feet, he'd still be climbing up to 5,000 feet daily. That's more than twice the height of the Empire State Building in New York.
35 feet from the ground, balancing with one hand on one branch. And by the way, palm trees don't really have branches, they have fronds. They're not your woody branches of regular trees. With one hand, he's holding a frond. With the other hand, he's cutting into the sap and then filling the pot. He'll come back two more times up that tree in a day because the pot gets filled in season. 350 trees, three times a day, up and down six times, take an average height of 20 feet. It's still greater than twice the height of the Empire State Building. Look at the height. His wife is cooking the molasses. Anyway, I'll get out of that one. You can go and see it. By the way, I have kept visiting cards, not of mine. I've never used a visiting card in my life because amongst the people where I work, it doesn't matter a damn. But there's a visiting card for Pari so that you know the website ID. Anindya, I think it's out there on the table there near the publications. Please feel free to take one and explore the talking albums. Our first talking album was shot by a 19-year-old Delhi girl, Punjabi, who said she wanted to do some work on her holiday. I said, do you know Kerala? She said, no. I said, do you know a word of Malayalam? She said, no. So we sent her off immediately the next day to Kerala to do some, because we are not believing in just output, we are believing in input. We want our journalists to spend time in a place and learn something about it. Learn to talk to people. We've divided India into 95 regions. Our aim is to place one Pari fellow for 3 months in every region in this country. We have 12 to 14 already in the field. Okay? We have right now a fellow called Rithayan Mukherjee, who's done one of the most spectacular railroad pictures, trains that I've seen. Rithayan. It is the last, this is the longest narrow gauge train in the world, in Madhya Pradesh, that Rithayan shot. But again, you're not going to see the photographs because the thing isn't, you're going to see blank. I'm going to take you to the videos which I have offline. Yeah, so, heck, hold on. I did have, okay, we'll go here. Temp present. Now, our focus, our emphasis is on labor and languages. The work people do, which means primarily, the work that doesn't get covered, which is primarily the work women do. Okay? It doesn't get covered. Women's work is not recognized as work. If you in the GDP, they don't calculate homework. They don't calculate that. Yeah. Because the economists don't do any homework. They don't do any work at home. So why are they going to calculate that as work? The male economists would dominate economics anyway. So, you know that, by the way, cow dung is a major industry. It saves you billions of dollars in imports of fossil fuels. Who collects cow dung in India? Have you ever seen a man do it? Never. It's women who do it. But cow dung is not registered on the stock exchange, though a lot of bullshit is. Right? So, Now, I'm taking you to little clips from across the country of ordinary people telling their stories. This is a 1 minute clip from Tripura, the number one state in the country for NREGS work. And suddenly, the new government in 2014 cuts Tripura's NREGS budget by 53%. And I am accosted by angry women workers at an NREGS site, especially Kajal Dev Burma. I'll tell you what she actually says. You know what she's saying? She asked me, what is all this Swachh Bharat crap about? I said, it's a toilet. She said, bah, don't talk to us about toilets. Because they had cut the budget for her. She's a widow with three children. Her husband was a driver who died in a road accident, head-on collision with a lorry. She said, if you are going to keep our stomachs empty, why do you need to build toilets? That's what she said. If you keep our stomachs empty, why do you need to build toilets, damn it? Starve us. Don't give us work. That's what she's saying. Now, this is from, again, the East. Okay, let me show you a phenomenal thing from Kerala on laborers who produce music, highly skilled laborers who produce music while they are working. Not, they don't take a break and produce the music. They don't sing and produce the music. They use their hammer and sickle and spanner and screwdriver to produce the music. These are highly skilled boat repair guys, okay? Watch them.
എല്ലാ ആശാരിമാരും ഇപ്പോൾ ഈ വള്ളപ്പണിക്ക് പണിയൊന്നും പരിചയമില്ല. എൻ്റെ പരിചയമുള്ളവർ അപൂർവം.
ഞാൻ ഒരു 10-20-30 വർഷം കൊണ്ട് ഈ ഫീൽഡിൽ വർക്ക് ചെയ്യും. പക്ഷെ അന്നൊന്നും ഇല്ലാത്ത രീതിയിൽ ഇന്ന് പരമ്പരാഗതമായി ഈ തൊഴിൽ നശിച്ചുകൊണ്ടിരിക്കുക.
ഇന്നിപ്പോൾ വന്ന് വന്ന് കൂലി അങ്ങ് വർദ്ധിച്ച് ഒരു 2 രൂപ ചെയ്ത ആൾക്ക് 2000 രൂപയാണ് ഇപ്പോൾ.
തോട് എല്ലാ ഭാഗത്തും തോട്ടല്ലേ ഇവിടെ എന്ന് പറഞ്ഞാൽ എല്ലാ ഭാഗത്തും തോട്ടല്ലേ.
ഞങ്ങളോട് കൂടിയ മിക്കവാറും ഞങ്ങളുടെ ഈ വീടുകളിലെ പണി നിന്നു.
ഓക്കെ, ദിസ് ഇസ് സുക്കൂർത്താങ് സൈമാർ, ഹു is the last authority of the Saimar language, of which there are only 7 speakers.
Julaya Kanhong, Julaya Ta Kanhonga, Pen Sharma Ngai Antam Tamo Chama, Thir Dhan Shehetta, An Shehetta, An Demingin, Halamin Nam Shuita.
He knows every herb, root, plant, berry in the forests of Tripura. When he's gone, that's gone. He is the Ojha. There he is called Ochayi. The Ojha is called Ochayi. He is the encyclopedia of Tripura's forests. What is it we are losing? Pung. Now we cover culture, music, everything. One of the finest television anchors in this country, former student, and an executive editor of the leading network, has contributed 3 films. She took leave from her work, made it because she wanted to see them on People's Archive, which would give them a lot more respect than mainstream television. Watch this. This is on the oldest guru, the oldest guru of Pung Cholom, telling the story of this unbelievable dance and drumming format.
Ibu pun ai bisina masih aku ni jantar pun mesti gigi mesti sudah ba.
By the way, the 2 things you will notice, the ethical protocols of Pari are: you will never see the filmmaker or hear the filmmaker. The focus is the subject. The subject owns the story. And the first credit is not to the filmmaker, but to the guru who is telling the story. He is telling you, he is sharing his story. Okay? The first credit goes to them. The second credit to the village or community if they help. The third credit is that of the filmmaker. That's one. Second, all these, we have volunteers who translate the subtitles. You can go up to YouTube and choose which language if volunteers. Volunteers only do for the stories they like or the subjects they like. So you will find, say, if you went to you will find we are carrying languages, we are carrying stories in up to 10 languages. At the heart of India, there are languages. Okay. See here, choose language. So we have multiple languages as well. And let me show you. You know, one of the most spectacular things, films we have up here, which I hope we can show you, is a Odia Dalit fisherman, part-time fisherman, called Purna Das, resisting POSCO's takeover of his village. He is barely functionally literate, but, oh, please, it went into the, it went into that, Purna Das. This was an extempore rendition of a song, a protest song. He did not hold a piece of paper. He composed that song in front of us. You'll all be able to follow it. The words are fairly simple. The Odia, Arere Neer Lojo POSCO Company Perija Dakshina Korea. Without music, without backup, without a band, without any instrument, he created this song and he sang it. Maybe it's buffering.
লোটি নেব ভাই আম পান ধান মা মাটি ঠারু করিবি স্থাপন লোটি নেব ভাই আম কাজু যে সজনা সবু নেব লোটি কাজু যে সজনা সবু নেব লোটি ছিড়াইব আম নড়িয়া আরে রে নীল জবস্ক কোম্পানি ফেরি যা দক্ষিণ কোরিয়া এ দ্বিতীয় কাশ্মীরি ঢিঙ্কিয়া ভুঁই লক্ষে লক্ষে লোক তাম থানু.
Well, you get the idea. Every region of this country has its troubadours, its poet singers. Every single region of the country has them. But we do not have them in a national legacy site. That's what we are there for. Okay? To collect these songs, the stories, as far as possible, told by people themselves. Speaking of school children, we filmed a debate, no teacher present on stage or below, of 12 to 13 year old children, 11 to 13 year old children, the same ones who made us a newspaper, Adivasi children, Dalit children, Irula tribals, living in, their school is called Vidya Vanam. It's a school in the forest, knowledge in the forest. You know what the kids debated at their school debate? I hated school debates. I loved debates when I went to university and they were political and open and you didn't have to bullshit about what you didn't believe in. These kids, in our school days, is Mahatma Gandhi still relevant? These were the kind of exotic debates we had. Yeah. But these kids debated. They worked on it and they debated genetically modified crops.
Good morning everyone, my name is Kalpana. I am the moderator of this debate. Today we are going to present a debate on genetically modified crops. The topic is genetically modified crops are beneficial or harmful to humans. On my right is the affirmative team and on my left is the negative team. I will give 1 minute to each speaker to present their points and I will give 1 minute to counter their points. Now, the first speaker from the affirmative team will start the debate.
Good morning everyone. My name is Kartika and first speaker of affirmative team. My first point is lack of vitamin A causes blindness in all over the world and it affects 50 million children. Vitamin A can be found in milk, butter, meat and yellow vegetables. Normal rice does not have very much of vitamin A. The most example of genetically modified rice is golden rice. Golden rice is called golden rice because it is in yellow color and it has more vitamin A. Golden rice also contain iron and zinc. Golden rice good for third world countries.
Now the time for countering.
There is no need of golden rice. Instead of that, we can drink. My name is Sukanya. I'm the first speaker of Have Been Lost. If we introduce genetically modified crops, our traditional varieties will be lost.
I'm going to cut it there so that you go and see it. It's an 11-minute film. They have raised every issue, both sides have raised all the issues connected with genetically modified crops. They've raised the issues of cross-pollination, perverse pollination, diversity, the death of diversity, does it add to nutritional value, each and every one of these things. 53% of the school are Irula tribals. We as Pari exist for that group of people. Tomorrow their textbook should be of this. They should be able to, you know, even in a rich country like Canada, there have been huge student protests over textbooks being too expensive. Kids have come in from working class immigrant backgrounds who can't afford textbooks costing $100, $80. The textbook debate now moves online. Kids should be able to do this. And I'll end with one example of what happened to me on that trip from Kalahandi to Koraput. My friend Purusottam and I were being driven by a young Sardar driver. His name, I'm not pulling your leg, and he is no relative of the more famous person of that name, but our young driver's name was Honey Singh. And no relative of the rapper. Yeah. Honey Singh, normally a driver on the highway never leaves his car. He will sleep in the car. When you eat at a dhaba, he will sit at the car and eat. But Honey Singh would get, he's never lived in a city in his life. He came from a village in Gurdaspur, orphan, to a village outside Raipur. His extended family in Raipur gave him a, told him, you will drive this car, tourist taxi, you will marry this girl and you will live in this flat. He did it. Wherever Purushottam and I got out at the heart to talk to people, Honey Singh would come and stand behind us and then he would do something. After this happened 10 times, I couldn't resist. I said, kya kar rahe ho Honey Singh? He said, Saab, jo aap kar raha hai na, bahut interesting lag raha hai mujhko. He said, I asked him, what are you doing? He said, sir, whatever you're doing is very interesting to me. What you and Purushottam Bhai are doing is very interesting to me. I said, yes, yes, yes. But so what are you doing? He said, jo bhi aap kar raha hai na, main mere Facebook page pe report kar raha hun. I said, let me see. First time I saw 9 photographs of myself in Punjab on a Punjabi Facebook page. Then I said, Honey Singh, these are decent photographs. I mean, if you can make Purushottam and me look like human beings, that's an achievement. Especially when we are on the road traveling. So I told him, try my Nikon. DSLR 800D, fabulous camera. He took photographs of the Chitrakoot Falls, which we will be carrying. And at lunch, he came up to us and said, Dekhiye sir, jo subah humne cover kiya aap log ka, 2 ghanta mein 84 like mila. Okay. I told Purushottam, this is our target audience. Okay? And he is our target contributor. Honey Singh should contribute. He should be writing from wherever he's traveling in his tourist taxi. He should be writing for Pari. This is the idea of Pari. Get as close as possible. Now, the Adivasi woman in the Bandipur forest, she has taken a photo essay. She's never owned a phone. She's never had a camera phone. Jared Margulies, the Fulbright scholar, gave her a camera. She has shot pictures that I would not dare do. Among other things, she has shot a full-grown leopard at 4 meters. I would be desperately wishing to be somewhere else. That leopard is sitting and looking very interestedly at her. And this is the middle of the forest. It's not a leopard that has strayed to the highway. The captions are her own statements. I love those statements. They are so natural, so unrehearsed. I saw this full-grown leopard. He was looking at me only. And he was just 4 meters away. I was scared. I wasn't so scared because I had come there to meet my husband who would be there in a minute. But on thinking again, still I was scared because even if my husband was there, if he attacks, what will we do? Okay, these are the captions. What a beautiful photo essay she's done. The leopard is just one picture. She shot birds. She's concerned about, she shot tiger pug marks. She shot the route taken by her nieces to school. How dangerous it is to tend the sheep and the cows along the forest track because of leopard and tiger attacks in Bandipur. You know, Dayanita Singh did something very interesting, and I'm doing this to provoke you to do what she came to the Hindu Lit Fest, the Hindu Literature Festival, Literary Festival, and asked the audience, how many of you consider yourself photographers? How many of you would say, I'm a photographer? Okay, 1, 2, okay, 3, 4. Then she asked, she said, wrong question, wrong answer. She said, how many of you have cell phones with cameras? How many of you have cell phones on which you have cameras? She said, that's how many photographers you are. We have, the Purna Das video was shot on a cell phone. It was shot on a cell phone, beautifully shot. Everyone in this country can, and outside this country, we've had students from abroad come and we are only 16 months or 18 months old. Right? We're not yet 2 years old. Imagine 10 years from now when we have thousands of stories readable in 10, 12, 15, 20 languages, when we have the database of songs which you're going to send me from Bengal as an equivalent to, you can't let the Marathis outdo you. Okay, I mean, have some pride. So do that. It's about taking journalism back to people. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much. One minute, sit here. Yeah, I'll.
Thank you very much, P.S., I mean, for opening up these windows to our mind. We will, I think many of us probably would want to have a brief conversation. I mean, because, there are many people who probably, and so if we can sort of open the floor for some conversations, if reflections, not question answers really, but if it can be kept brief and
this is a very logistic question, but I think it's essential to something like this surviving, is how do you fund this?
Okay, can I have? The most fundamental question of all, right? We've only just begun fundraising for 3 reasons. One, we want it funded by people, okay, for crowdfunding, by individuals. And second, we are staying away from direct grants by governments and corporations. Foundations, we'll look at the foundation. I'm not going to be very excited by certain large foundations in the country. Yeah, but so far nothing has happened on any of those fronts. My attitude is, if Government of India Labour Ministry wants a film on rural labour, I'll make it for them as P. Sainath. Pay me. You will never carry that film because you're the Labour Department. When you finally look at what it is, you're not going to carry it. But I'll do it for you. That's a straight transaction between a freelance journalist and a client or whatever you want to call them. But we will not take grants from the Labour Ministry and be told what to do. Same rule with corporations. Now, the project we have, Cover Your Country, it's going to cost 4 crores. Pari has, by the way, let me tell you, got more than 1.5 crores in free labor by 40 software engineers who built this platform. They are young people in their 20s who earn per hour they're billing in the US, because they do their work there. They earn $13, they're sitting in Madras or Chennai, they will do work which goes there. They are billed at $13 per hour. About 30-40 of them gave us 445 hours. You do the calculation, it's 52 lakhs. Then there are the seniors and the super seniors who are billed at $40 an hour up to $100 an hour. They have given us some 70-80 hours. Okay, so that's how it was done. The basic fund came from a number of journalism awards, which I won, which, like, a part of it, actually much of the Magsaysay money went to farmer widows in Vidarbha, but there have been awards since then. And, yeah, but some of it is there. And the World Media Summit, $6 lakhs, $10,000. So that money went in there. All the core group members, there are about, oh, another thing, by the way, the trustees who run the counter media trust that runs PARI, 2/3 are women. The core group of 21-22, 3/4 are women. Okay. All the 5 editors, video editor, copy editor, chief copy editor, except for the tech editor, all the editors are women. Photo editor, video editor, copy editor, everything. Now, all the core group members put their work free. We are all volunteers who are holding day jobs. I don't know what the hell they're actually able to do on their day jobs anymore, because I know how much work I get out of them for PARI. Okay, so that's... Then all of us put every month something into it to be able, like, we have interns in Shantiniketan or somewhere. These kids are willing to do it just by themselves, but we insist on paying them something. So one is, we are dependent on individual donations. There are only so many awards in the world, and I'm afraid I've run out of them. So we have to do something there. We are doing, how are we going to pay for that Cover Your Country, where every region has a fellow? I told you, it's going to cost, just for the fellowships, it's going to cost 2.5 crores. I'm particular that the fellowships are good, because I spent half my career on fellowships, and they are really shitty. And the money you get, when I did the biggest fellowship in India that at that time, I was to do 10 districts, I was bankrupt by the second. I sold cameras. I don't want my students or potential students to go through that. So the fellowship is 2 lakhs in the hand of the fellow. Okay? There'll be nearly 100 fellows, because 95 regions and 5 non-regional fellows. Ritayan Mukherjee is a non-regional fellow, the guy whose story I showed you. He is shooting the pastoral nomadic communities of the Indo-Tibetic plateaus, okay, and the rubberies of Kutch, like that. So then the cost of having editors, translators, you just add it up. All our translators are voluntary, but The volunteer is only going to translate the article he or she likes and feels like translating. So we've got to do some professional translation. Comes to over 4 crores, we will subsidize it like we've been doing until we run out. But this is what we've done. We've opened up a thing called Cover Your Country, where anyone can contribute anything they want, debit card, credit card, online. And it was very sweet to see pensioners, because I think of the freedom struggle category, we got 100, 200 and 500 from 3 pensioners in their 80s. But we also got very generous sums of 50,000, 1 lakh from various people. Now we have created a thing, Club of 3,000. We are looking for 3,000 individuals in this country who will give us a minimum of 10,000 and hopefully commit that for 3 years. If we can meet that, we'll do it. 3,000 people giving you 10,000 is 3 crores. There's still 1.5 crores to come in from us. We'll raise that each year. Because I want that when, this will take 5 years. 100 fellows, 16, 20 fellows in a year, no office can handle, and Pari works out of 20 laptops. Okay? We now have an imaginary office space, which is, I also call home. And kids work out of there, interns work out of there. We've taken an space above us. We are in this is in Bandra, where the rents are higher than Manhattan. But lots of young people are coming and working there, including the one who's from Shantiniketan, who's made 2 beautiful films on weavers, Sanchita Maji, all of this. And if we can get that 10,000 from 3,000 people, the remaining 1.5 crores comes from us in labor. It doesn't mean that you have to give just 10,000. On the one hand, you can give like the pensioners gave 500 rupees. Okay? I'm touched by that. An 82, 83-year-old guy has sent us from his monthly pension of next to nothing, he has sent us 500 rupees. It means somebody loves us. Okay? So you don't have to give 10,000, you can give 50,000. If you gave me 50,000, we'd count that as 5 units. Out of the 3,000, we'd count that as 5 units. Somebody gave us 10 lakhs, we count that as 100 units. We have to meet 3,000 units in a year or drown. My guess is we'll drown, but it'll have been great fun. It'll have been great fun. We'd have created unbelievable quality of content. So that's our... Yeah, there's a...
It was a wonderful presentation, and thank you so much for that. 2 things struck me, and I would like to ask both questions. First one was, there was a point when you actually compared with Wikipedia, the work that you're doing. Given the vastness of this country, it is bound to be that at some stage, probably the number of people who are doing quality control from your end would not be sufficient to, like, you know, do it. I mean, it's bound to go up. So what are your plans for them? One of the reasons why Wikipedia has succeeded is because they have allowed a whole army of people to just come in and do that work. So that's the first thing. There's another thing which probably is a little bit more controversial, which is, when you are like essentially documenting for future generations what is an entire ethnographic and, like, you know, cultural map of India, there are also parts of culture which are probably not very, where you would probably need to have, for want of a better word, censorship. There are sexual subcultures within India which are problematic by the culture vultures of today who are ruling us. There are subcultures which are gender variant. One of the things I was remembering when you were talking of the movies is one of our friends, she's from Manipur, and she's made this movie about the transgender of Manipur, the traditional transgender Manipur. I was thinking that would be a wonderful film to, like, you know, actually go up on that. But then there are also, there, at the same time, I also thought of another film, which is also made by one of our friends, who's done it on the Londa Nach tradition in north, northern Bihar and, eastern UP and northern Bihar. And that has got a lot of sexual content. That has got a lot of violence. That is not sanitized for a general audience. How would you deal with these situations?
I get it. Let me start answering before I forget all your questions. One, those are very well thought out questions. About Wikipedia and the army of editors, we are building the army. See, we have 12, 14 editors, top quality, top notch editors, 30 years, 35 years experience, spread out in India, two or three of them in the US, doing this voluntarily. So our editor distributes copy, okay? Second, it's very more complicated in our case because we are not Wikipedia articles. Every piece is a full-fledged multimedia digital production. So there is a lot of back and forth between the editor, author, photographer. Okay, send me a thumbnail of this. Okay, you said Wajipur. Wajipur, which district, which block. Therefore, our production timelines are much more lengthy and delayed. Fact. But we want that quality. Okay, and as things happen, if we make some money, the first thing we are going to do very soon is to have a full-time copy chief. And that only covers text, but we are also audio, video, still photo, right? So we are going to need people, and that's why we are going to need more and more money above that 3 crores. But there will be a core editor, and then there will be part-timers. And we have a hell of a lot of volunteers. We have 1,700 volunteers online, from techies to editors. I've not been able to absorb that number. As the project expands, then. But it's also finding out about people I'd never met before. I haven't met to this day. It's very complicated. Believe me, it can be done. It will be done. And that the quality control thing is very important. See, Wikipedia's anarchy, personally, I have benefited from it. You know, for many years, 5-6 years, until a student of mine irritatingly changed it. They had my entry, making me 4 years older than I was. I was 53. This was quite recently. I was 53, and they made me 57, and they carried a photograph next to it of when I was a 26-year-old, making me the youngest looking 57-year-old in the planet, which I was quite pleased with. So I let it be. Some goody two-shoes student of mine said error and changed it. I was very annoyed with her and told her that. You know, I liked that. I liked the way I looked there. Yeah, but so that's Wikipedia. You don't want that. The second thing about what we'll carry. Yes, we would carry, but what we carry on all subjects, okay? But there are 2-3 things that I will emphasize. One is, it's got to fit our mandate. Everyday lives, everyday people. It's got to fit that mandate. Second, the story has not got to be told by the filmmaker. We don't accept filmmaker-narrated stories. We want the person at the center. Now, and that's why I said it's a great textbook, because suppose you're a sociology student having to do a project on women, rural women labor. Would you rather read a 25-year-old textbook written 35 years ago and author and text are both dead, or would you rather listen to that woman on Pari who's telling you about her life as an agricultural laborer? Which is the more insightful? That was the second thing. The third thing. Our Kerala fellow, Shashi Kumar, is shooting a film on that unique temple in Kerala where you have the 3-day transgender festival every year. We will carry that film he will shoot it in the format that we demand. Okay? Then we also are conscious of the fact that there are certain, by the way, two things we do avoid. Yeah? You can call it censorship, whatever. I want absolutely everybody to be able to read Pari. So rather than, I am a political person. I'm a very political person and have been all my life. But we have not kept opinion pages on Pari. Okay? We have not kept opinion pages. So that people can, you know, somebody who has an entirely different political worldview will not stop his or her children from reading Pari. And we think that telling stories through the lives of people is irrefutable. Correct? So, if I write something in an opinion column, now we are carrying terrific stuff on caste. Our first launch film is about a Dalit boy in Tamil Nadu, Kali. I'm so proud of our intervention there. He's a Dalit. He lives in a village where untouchability is practiced. His aim in life was not to be a software engineer or a techie. He wanted to be, and is today famous, a classical Bharatanatyam dancer. Okay? He was seen by Leela Samson, who gave him a chance, and the only Dalit ever to have entered Kalakshetra in a role other than a toilet cleaner or a janitor, came out with a distinction and a first class. Now doing postgraduate studies, part of the full course, a part of the teachers, and we've looked at but we did two things. We only let him tell the story and let him tell what he wanted to emphasize. That's his right. If he says there are certain areas he doesn't want to visit, how can I force him or compel him to do that? The next part, say about violence, there we are conscious of the fact that we are trying to get school children to the website. Right? So we will look at films in that light, we will look at stuff in that light. And by the way, I think we carry a lot on violence, but not in physical violence. I think displacement is an incredible violence. We carry lots of stories on displacement. We carry lots of stories on water conflicts, resource conflicts, where there is an enormous amount of violence. Gandhi said poverty is the ultimate violence. Okay? We carry that. But we are conscious of the fact that I want your kids to see the site. Yeah? I don't want someone being ripped apart and beaten to death by a mob for that. Boss, there are 1,000 other sites happy and eager to carry that. About minorities and sexual minorities, I have to tell you, there are several characters on Pari's site who are from the LGBT, who are from the LGBT community. Okay? They are living in rural India in extremely conservative places. It is from my point of view, it's entirely their choice and decision whether to come out with it or not. I have no right, moral or journalistic, to push them into that disclosure. But they're there, believe me, they are there. And also, I'd like to think that these minorities are deeply involved in issues other than identity issues. You know, I think to reduce them to that is also to play to a stereotype.
Thank you. I mean, for many of us, on the note that you ended on is so relevant, because I think we are struggling with this. We are struggling, and very difficultly actually, to balance this whole the whole need for an identity and then and also sort of being swamped by identity politics, and also the fact that, I mean, the whole push for mainstreaming, quote unquote, and how do you balance that with the politics of being invisibilized. I think that's a constant conversation and a struggle. One of the things that we would really like you to announce is something that we would really be privileged, actually, that Pratoy is announcing an award for reporting on transgender rights. There are flyers to this outside. It's basically been inspired by what has been a tradition here in Calcutta by a very reputed media house, which had a reporting on rural, award on rural reporting, and of which, of course, like you said, you had one way back in 95. This, I would request P. Sainath to please inaugurate. It is the Pratoy Gender Trust Award for reporting on transgender rights. We're really trying to create a space where, like, we are not just reported as oddities and what sort of lipstick color we want to use, and that there are other policy implications for our lives and what the role that state is playing. Thank you very, very much.
Thank you. I think that's an important development. I think the creation of an award does open up spaces for reporting.
Thank you very, very much. We would like to end that today.
Thank you.